Hello and welcome to the Fantasy Flex podcast presented by Prize Picks. I'm your host, Samantha Previte. On today's episode of 21 Questions, I am so happy to be joined by the one and only Brad Evans, who's the EP of gaming content at Bally Sports, who you can find on SiriusXM on Fade the Noise and on Twitter at Noisy Huevos. Welcome to the Fantasy Flex, Brad. Do I dare even ask how your week 10 was?
Oh God, it was a bloodbath in the player props market. I can tell you that right now. It was a roller coaster ride for fantasy devices. But I do have AJ Dillon. So, ooh, you know, much to the chagrin of Aaron Jones backers, and I'm glad that Jones has only got a sprained MCL, so I'm going to miss a game or two. But man, you want to talk about the battering ram? I'm going to saddle up that Clydesdale and ride him these next couple of weeks. I think he's going to be easily a top 10 fantasy back, maybe even top five. So there's one silver lining, an otherwise wasteful weekend for me.
Well, that is definitely good. It's been two crazy weeks in a row. And I know I feel like we always say this is a crazy week. Have you ever seen a week like this? But these have actually been two crazy weeks. Double digit dogs, winning games, my Carolina Panthers overcoming a lot of things. Cam Newton, obviously. So a lot of things happening. The NFL feels almost like a little bit more random and a little bit more like, you know, everyone's game. Maybe not everyone, maybe not if you're the Jets or the Lions, but a lot of teams.
Hey, they got a tie. That's a win, right, Samantha?
I know Najee Harris didn't even know you could tie, so must be nice. Well, anyway, we will just jump right into our 21 questions. So the first question is, what year did you start playing fantasy and did you win your first league?
I did not win my first league, but I started playing fantasy football in 1995, believe it or not, with some friends at a pizza joint in Champaign, Illinois that I played with. We used to do it by hand. I was a league commissioner, and I would be using like a 28A connection on Sunday nights, waiting for an eternity for the stats to load. I remember those days. Broadband just changed my life, Samantha, let me tell you. Because once you got to the high-speed internet connections, the commissioner services and all that jazz, and you're a young woman, so you may have no idea of what I'm talking about. But, you know, back in those times, it was like Galapagos tortoise slow. It was like Benny Snell slow when it was all said and done. So it would take me hours on end just to tally up. And I physically call people over the phone, be like, hey, here are the results. This is how you did. I remember it took Barry Sanders with my first pick, so that worked out well. And I had Jeff George. I went to University of Illinois, and I love guys with mullet and mustache combinations. Don't ask me why. And he had an outstanding one. So I remember fondly my first year in fantasy, though it did not finish on a high note.
Well, I love stories like this, even though I cannot necessarily relate to them. They are super wholesome. Do you still play in that league right now?
No, that thing blew up a long time ago, but I do play in a local league, the Rig Grange Invitational. It is a salary cap slash auction format that I've been doing for, God, I don't know, 20 years. And we have, you know, kind of the same core of guys that are in it. Some have fallen by the wayside, but for the most part, there's a good 7 or 8 that are OGs in that league. And now that I'm back in town, we got together, had a huge spectacular blowout in the basement. It was a blur after about 30 players were thrown out in the beginning of the draft because there was a lot of beverages flowing. I'll say that much. Oh my
goodness. That is hilarious. That is a really fun story. All right. What are the best and worst parts about playing fantasy football for you?
Well, I mean, the best parts, to be honest with you, are probably the worst parts for a lot of people. I love the randomness of it all, the unpredictability of it. You know, there are surprises that lurk around every single corner. You know, you look at a guy like Rhamondre Stevenson and, you know, just in near term, because, you know, it's fresh on the mind, you know, nobody wants to try to get in the treacherous mind of Bill Belichick. I call him Bill Beazelcheck because I think he is devilish in many ways. And, you know, he's untrustworthy and, you know, you got to put your waivers out there on the line. And we weren't really sure what Stevenson was going to get this past weekend, but If you had the confidence and or maybe you were just desperate enough, you threw him in your lineup, you know, 100 and plus total yards on 24 touches, a couple of touchdowns out of nowhere. That's the kind of stuff I love. And I love the stories of the undrafted free agents that hit it big or the late round picks in the NFL that hit it big, like an Elijah Mitchell right now. You know, we were all talking about Trey Sermon back in August. And, you know, Kyle Shanahan zigged while the rest of us zagged, and Mitchell's been indispensable for fantasy purposes. So that's the best part for me. The worst part are the injuries. You can't see them coming. It creates so much chaos and upheaval. I'm speaking as somebody who was a Derrick Henry enthusiast who had him on, I don't know, a multitude of rosters. We're rocking, we're rolling, and then the train derailed. And it's like, all right, you could say, well, why did you have his handcuff? Well, we had no idea who his handcuff would be. We still don't really know. We're working through that. Isn't the ancient one Adrian Peterson? Is it D’Onta Foreman who was signed off the trash heap with a little Jeremy McNichols mixed in? I mean, again, I guess it speaks to the randomness, which I should like, but it would pertains to me, and I'm crushing in my fantasy league, and then the injury crushes my soul by taking out my superstar. That sucks.
Derrick Henry injury, definitely soul crushing. I was just going to ask you if you were over leveraged in Derrick Henry shares this season.
Yes.
Certainly disappointing. Uh-huh. And to your point, I love that a couple of weeks ago, the biggest topic was like, should we roster Adrian Peterson or Jeremy McNichols? And the answer was neither. So
right, exactly.
Definitely a lot of randomness. And Rhamondre Stevenson, I actually did start him in two leagues, which
very nice.
Yeah, I'm going to just be honest, and honesty is important. I'm going to be honest that those teams stink. So that's why I even had him on my team at the time, but it happens. And I mean, in that sense, the randomness worked out for me. All right. Jumping into the actual football stuff, we are going to kick it off with a quick segment called the Burn Book, which is of course a Mean Girls reference. So as fantasy managers, it's so easy to have recency bias, especially if a player has burned us either due to injuries or a bad week. So I'm going to run through five players, and I'd like you to briefly tell us how confident you are in that player moving forward, or if they're in your burn book. So our first question is Aaron Rodgers. So I'm not a crazy person. I'm not asking if you're burning him completely, but and the Packers did pick up a win in this game, but Rodgers didn't throw a single touchdown, completed 23 of 37 for 292 yards and zero touchdowns, one interception. It's his second straight appearance with under 20 fantasy points. Is he maybe burned out of that must start matchup proof tier though?
I mean, I think it's debatable right now. And, you know, I'm a matchup advocate. And, you know, he had a splendid paper matchup against Seattle. But that game just, it was rancid from start to finish. Just a putrid performance by both quarterbacks, really. Just odd as well. I mean, Russell Wilson, not so much. We knew there was going to be some accumulated rust there. The questions about his gripping ability with the finger and his ability just to throw the ball accurately. You know, him saying, oh, I work 19 hours a day to get back in shape. Dude, it's a finger. Maybe you should have been, you know, reading the defense is better in the scouting report than, you know, working out with little, you know, thumb war or finger exercises. I don't know. It didn't work out for
him. He's out there playing Madden or something. And that's the finger exercise.
Yeah, I mean, the deadliest weapon the Russell's got right now are his legs. That's about it. So, you know, for me, I'm going to give Aaron Rodgers a pass. It was an odd week with the circumstances, you know, obviously revolving around the controversial statements that he made and the backlash that he suffered from that and not being at practice. I mean, he basically came in cold in a very cold environment, which he's used to, and delivered very chilly results in the end. You got to remember he had seven games prior in a row of multi-touchdown performances. He's going to get back to that starting this week. And it's Minnesota, and he's got my Bears on the horizon, and they're terrible. So he'll be just fine. I'm staying the course. I'm not putting him in the burn book. I would trust Aaron Rodgers this week and every week moving forward.
Yeah, I think you have to give Aaron Rodgers a pass just from, you know, his coaching staff, his upside. I am certainly not taking him out of my lineups. All right. The next guy we're going to talk about is Jerry Jeudy. Since returning from his injury in week one, he's been largely tepid for fantasy purposes, maybe not totally his fault, but caught 6 of 9 targets for 48 yards last week and now has the bye. So I want to know kind of what your rest of season outlook on Jerry Jeudy is. And are we maybe burning him possibly just due to the Broncos offense as a whole?
Oh, yeah, the Broncos. Jekyll and Hyde. I mean, definition of it, right? You go and you clobber the Cowboys, and you de-pant the Cowboys, and then you turn around and de-pant yourselves at home. Like, it's just a bizarre set of circumstances. I don't know what version you're going to get week in, week out. You know, Teddy Two Gloves is really indecipherable in what he brings to the table. So, I think Jerry Jeudy is a wide receiver 3, likely rest of the season. I'm actually more concerned about Cortland Sutton since Jerry Jeudy's return. But, you know, Judy's still getting the volume. He's consistently getting 6 receptions in the game. He's done that at all but one contest so far this season. And you look at the rest of the season schedule, Samantha, you know, there's some nice matchups in there. Kansas City got on the horizon, Detroit, Cincinnati's got all kinds of issues right now in that secondary. That's the first round of the fantasy playoffs. Vegas, you saw him get picked apart on Sunday Night Football, resurrecting Patrick Mahomes. You know, so there's some nice matchups that he can exploit. I'm going to stay the course with Jeudy. I'm not going to go overboard, but wide receiver 3-12 team league sounds about right for me.
Yeah, I would definitely put him in that tier. And I think that many managers can't afford to burn him quite yet. So yeah. I am leaving him in, at least on my bench, in a lot of lineups. All right. The next thing we're going to talk about, a guy that really, really started out hot, it's Mike Williams. And he has seriously fallen off a cliff since that crazy start, has not crested the double digit fantasy mark since week 5, was another disappointing game against the Vikings this week with just 5 points in half PPR. Does Williams belong in managers' burn books?
I am concerned because we have a pattern of ineptitude here with Mike Williams. And, you know, it's just he's out of rhythm right now with Justin Herbert. And there's some concentration issues there as well. I mean, he dropped a touchdown this last weekend. Would have been an easy 6. He was wide ass open, botched it. You know, it happens. And, you know, but this is 4 games in a row now where he's just not getting it done. I mean, since week 6, he's wide receiver 61 in fantasy total points scored in a half point PPR setting. Over that stretch, just a 52.6% catch rate. You know, the good news is he's still seeing a pretty high red zone share. He's got 8 red zone targets over that stretch again since week 6. So the opportunities are there. He just needs to have a carpe diem moment. He needs to seize it again, get that confidence back up. I don't know when it's going to come, but I'm going to bench him until further notice. He has got to regain my trust because he has now fallen outside of that circle of trust.
Yeah, he's definitely outside of the circle of trust for me too. You know, I don't know if you're also in Scott Fish, I assume, because everyone is in the Scott Fish League. So I thought I had a great team with Christian McCaffrey as my first round pick and Mike Williams, who I thought was like such a great late round find. And of course, this team has gone so off the rails. So I can't tell if that was just one of those like weird early season blips or if this is like maybe he can kind of turn it around. Last week, not this week, week 9, they had like 3 tight ends that had touchdowns. And I was like, could just one of those go to Mike Williams something? Like, who are these guys that are getting touchdowns? So it's been definitely a little frustrating, especially if, you know, you were relying on him like I was. All right. The next guy we're going to talk about is Adrian Peterson, but it's kind of more of a question about the Titans backfield at large, which we alluded to at the beginning. Peterson found the end zone in week 9, albeit on a very impressive 2.1 yards per carry. Posted just 3 fantasy points in week 10 behind D’Onta Foreman, who really just looked better than both Peterson and McNichols. So my question kind of is, does this entire backfield belong in the burn book, or is there someone that you are trusting going
forward? Well, it's definitely not Adrian Peterson. He's a cuckoo. He's done. I mean, the 2.11 yards after contact per attempt these last couple of games, 1 missed tackle forced and 18 rush attempts. I mean, that says it all. I know it's a small sample size. You know, we heard on the broadcast too over the weekend, it's like, oh, well, he's still got that spin move. Okay. I mean, he might spin off a guy, but he's getting tackled by the next guy probably for like a 1-inch gain. It's just not getting it done in the trenches. D’Onta Foreman is 11 years younger than him. He's got far more juice in the legs. He is a more effective producer in the pass game, evidenced by the 2 catches for 48 yards in week 10. And I think moving forward, you're going to see Foreman start really gaining the upper hand here. I think he's going to get anywhere between 13 to 15 touches per game. And Samantha, you know what narrative we got coming up? Revenge game!
Revenge game against the Texans, yes.
So, you know, is Foreman in the RB2 conversation in deeper formats? Absolutely he is. And Jeremy McNichols will still supplant him occasionally on third downs. But I like what the former 2,000-yard rusher at the University of Texas is doing, though nobody at the University of Texas right now likes their current product because they lost to Kansas over the weekend. Yes, Kansas.
Brutal.
Not basketball, in football.
Yeah, absolutely brutal. Yeah, I agree with you. Of the three guys, I would say Adrian Peterson is the one that I'm least excited about. I think maybe we just made too much about the volume, but I had concerns right after Henry went down. I was like, yeah. I feel like Vrabel's just going to make this a messy backfield, kind of similar to the way like the Ravens backfield is basically unusable for fantasy purposes after they lost like five running backs in the preseason. So he's definitely been less impressive. I think McNichols maybe more incorporated in game scripts where they may be more competitive or trailing more, but in these game scripts with against Houston, like I don't see it happening. So D’Onta Foreman is the guy for me, certainly a good waiver wire target this week. All right, the final guy we're going to talk about in the burn book is Dalton Schultz. So he briefly looked like he could be a league winner early on, but he had another quiet game in what should have been a positive week 10 matchup against the Falcons, caught just one of two targets for 14 yards. He just seems to be down the priority list now behind CeeDee Lamb, Amari Cooper, Tony Pollard, and even Michael Gallup, who is back now, returned for the first week since week one. Schultz has just 11 fantasy points in half PPR in the last three games combined. So are we burning him out of the tight end one tier?
Yeah, I think you have to. And, you know, tight end is a desolate wasteland right now. There's no doubt about it. And by the way, I do like Adam Trautman. If you're desperately seeking some assistance there, his arrow is ascending right now while Schultz's is pointing in the opposite direction. And I think a lot of it has to do with Michael Gallup. We all feared this. You know, once Gallup would come back off of injured reserve, you know, you're spreading the love even more now for Dak. Gallup played brilliantly, by the way. Had a toe tap on the sideline. He looked vintage. He runs clean routes. He's explosive down the field. He's, you know, unafraid going across the middle. That's a lot of the stuff that Dalton Schultz does. So with Amari Cooper there, with CeeDee Lamb there, with Gallup now back in the fold, you know, utilize the running backs in the pass game as well. Yeah, Schultz, I think, is on the outside looking in of the QB1 class in 12-team leagues moving forward.
Rank these, as a follow-up, rank these three tight ends, Dan Arnold, Tyler Conklin, and Dalton Schultz, rest of season.
Your order is correct. It actually goes Dan Arnold first for me. Hey, Arnold, it's going to continue to get it done. I mean, look, Trevor Lawrence, we all thought it was going to be a lock for Offensive Rookie of the Year, and he has had his struggles, to say the least. But Jacksonville strangely is gaining confidence. An Urban Meyer coach team, I call Urban Meyer the raging nincompoop because it's exactly what he is. He's such an ill fit for the NFL. But they're starting to show some competitive spirit here, playing some tight games. And a lot of that has to do with the fact that, you know, Dan Arnold has been an integral part of this offense, whether native game scripts, positive game scripts, competitive games, that is here to stay. And now Conklin, you know, he had the two touchdown performance against the Chargers over the weekend. He has benefited from some very generous matchups specifically to the position. So, you know, I think it's going to be more of a roller coaster ride, more unpredictable for him rest of season, where I think, you know, Dan Arnold is a fixture as probably a 7-8 target per game guy here down the stretch.
I love what Arnold has done because, you know, we always talk about the tight end position being so touchdown dependent, and Arnold's doing it without any touchdowns, zero touchdowns this year, but he has such a great floor because of the targets, and he's just putting up production even in difficult matchups like against the Bills. So I have been very pleased with what I have seen from him. All right, that'll do it for the burn book. Our next segment is called Full Send or That's Cap, which, Brad, I need to know, do you ski or do any kind of like extreme sports?
No, I lived in Colorado for 7 years, Samantha, and I never skied. I have this like strange belief that if I get on skis, I'm going to shred a groin. It's going to be over. That's a wrap. That's done. No. I have no athletic ability whatsoever either. So that doesn't really help me. If you give me a toboggan, if you give me a giant inflated tube where I could just rest in it with a beer in my left hand and somebody pushes me down a mountainside, I'm in.
I love that. Well, first, I'm going to be teaching skiing at Breckenridge part-time this season. So if you want to come by for a ski lesson, you're always welcome. But anyway, the reason why is full send is kind of like an extreme sports term, which means like you're going for it. You're going head first, like you love it. And then cap is obviously more of a Gen Z term. That's like, that's crap. That's not real. That's BS. So Basically, it's the opposite of the last segment. I'm going to give you five players whose values are on the rise. And I want to know, are you sending it on this player or is that cap? So the first player, Cam Newton, my Cam Newton, was surprisingly active for this week after getting signed by the Panthers, although PJ Walker got the start, a determination that was made before Newton was signed. And he definitely made the most of his usage. I mean, he scored twice on his first two snaps. Given the salary that he was paid, I think it's obviously unlikely that Newton rides the bench for even more than 1 week. So my question is, are we going full send on Newton as a potential streamer as early as next week against the football team whose defense is very Swiss cheesy, or is that cap?
No. I mean, given that qualification, the stream qualification, it's full send for me. I mean, here's the thing about Cam Newton. You know, everybody talks about how inaccurate he was with the New England Patriots, but the advanced analytics really don't bear that out. You know, Pro Football Focus, he was QB 13 in adjusted completion percentage last season. Hell, he was top five in deep ball completion percentage. Now, more limited sample size in that latter category, but where is Cam's value really reside? It resides with his legs. And he is the most efficient, you could argue the most effective runner inside the 5 yard line, regardless of position. You know, he's got the ball in his hands inside the five, calls his own number. He's falling forward. He can bounce it outside. He's got enough speed. You saw that in Arizona. He's back. And all of its, you know, glorious celebration. And I think there are a lot of people in fantasy land, me being one of them. I'm in a super flex and two quarterback league. I picked up Cam everywhere last week when I heard the news. Then I saw the contract. I was like, oh, hell yeah. That cat's going to be starting the rest of the season. No doubt about it. So, you know, you got two teams on bye coming up here in week 11. Teddy Two Gloves going to be on a one-week siesta. Also, Matthew Stafford on a one-week siesta. So if you're a Stafford manager and you're looking for somebody to plug and play, Cam Newton against the low PSI deflated fighting footballs of Washington, who have allowed the most fantasy points, as you mentioned, to the quarterback position. He could throw for a buck 85. He could throw for a touchdown. He could raise the floor with 40 plus on the ground. And as well as he normally does, score six with his legs. So I think Cam Newton is going to be right there in the top 15 conversation week in and week out henceforth.
Yeah, here's what I love about Cam. I mean, I love a lot of things about Cam. I love everything. Actually, I just love everything about him because I love his style. I love just everything. But, you know, he's got more weapons, obviously, than he had last year with the Patriots. I think that's pretty safe to say with DJ Moore and Christian McCaffrey. Yep. And so I think that that supporting cast is going to really help him. And then I think that there's always going to be those design runs and packages for him that it's going to give you fantasy value. He's going to vulture touchdowns away from Christian McCaffrey, which is going to be really frustrating in a way, but certainly good if you want to roster him. He could really, I think, win people some seasons. So there will be some off weeks, but in a lot of times it's going to be ugly. Like, that's the thing. Like, it's not the prettiest. Sometimes it's like watching, I don't know, Jalen Hurts. But they get the job done. They get the job done for fantasy, and that's all that matters. All right. We have already talked about Rhamondre Stevenson, but I want to talk about him again. The truthers can obviously rejoice now after his long-awaited breakout in week 10 with Damian Harris sidelined in the concussion protocol. He saw 20 carries for 100 yards and a pair of touchdowns. I certainly don't want to detract from this fantastic performance, but his role and subsequent outlook is somewhat contingent on the game script and Harris being out. That said, Bill Belichick is notoriously unpredictable, as you mentioned earlier. So when it comes to running backs, that could maybe work in Stevenson's favor. Are we going full send on Stevenson as a potential flex play, even if Harris is healthy next week, or is trusting any Patriots running back not named Damian Harris cap?
Well, look, it's the deep fried Falcons, Samantha. It's done. I mean, Atlanta showed their true colors against the Dallas Cowboys. They're going to be down Cordarrelle Patterson. They are atrocious. They really are. And defensively as well. So full send with my guy, Rhamondre Stevenson. credit to Brandon Funson for the bad romance reference there. But we're huge fans of him. We talk about him on the SiriusXM show all the time. You know, it really impressed me too, you know, this last week, besides the volume, you know, you look under the hood, it's the fact that he had 3.20 yards after contact per attempt. So he was that battering ram. He was that arm tackle busting running back that we saw in the preseason with the first team live and in living color. So, you know, against Atlanta, that ranks inside the top five in most fantasy points allowed at the running back position. Even with Harris back, I think he's going to get anywhere between 11 to 14 touches in this game. And that is enough for flexy, sexy appeal. So, yeah, I'm going to start him with confidence. And I also have him in a 14-team league, and he will be in my lineup. You can make damn sure of that this week.
Well, that is really good to hear. Obviously, I thought he looked great. And it's one of those things that's like, you can't put the GD back in the bottle. Like, you, after you've seen him do it, like, I feel like they have to incorporate him. And I just hope that he doesn't miss a meeting, wear the wrong color to upset Bill Belichick, whatever. God forbid he fumbles and he's on waivers the next day. Yeah. So, you know, we talked about the randomness. It's there. It's especially there with the Patriots, but I am as full send as I can be with him. All right. The next guy we're going to talk about, we've already talked about this Jags offense, but someone else, Jamal Agnew. It was a strange week for Agnew, who caught zero passes on five targets against a Colts exploitable secondary, but then tallied three carries for 79 yards and a touchdown on the ground. Kind of just strange because the Colts run defense is pretty good, but they're kind of using him. He's like everything we hoped LaVisca Chenault would be in this Urban Meyer offense. I know it hurts me too, because I was like president of the LaVisca Chenault fan club. So my question is, are we going full send on Agnew as a viable wide receiver three flex play rest of season?
No, I'm capping that. Look, he is unreliable. He is untrustworthy. You know, the jet sweep action is great, you know, and I think that's where he's most effective. And that's what you saw this last week and him scoring the long touchdown against the Colts. But, you know, the target share, it's just mediocre. You know, it doesn't really move the needle for me. You know, he's got five targets or more in four straight games. But it's just, you know, a bit up and down. And, you know, for me, I need somebody that I can put my trust in on a weekly basis at the flex and wide receiver three position. I think there are better options that are out there. And I just, you know, I'm not going to, you know, look at Jamal Agnew and just think, oh, wow, this is the week that he's all of a sudden going to get all these jet sweeps. This is the week he's going to get like 7-8 targets. I'm confidently hitting that bam button and submitting him in my lineup. I just don't ever feel like I'm going to get that feeling. But then again, I haven't felt warm and fuzzy about a Jacksonville Jaguar since the Fred Taylor days. So it's been a minute.
That is really funny. I will say that I started him in two leagues.
Wow, that's
I know. It was ballsy. Well, it was a little it was a little ballsy though. Bye weeks were just really hard on me in one of my leagues. I had a whole like the whole bench was all bye week guys. So I had to make some difficult calls, but I was glad to see that. I mean, that's not the way I thought he was going to get it done. I was like, "Oh, this Colts secondary is trash. He'll definitely get it done for the air and then zero catches." But yes, but to your point, that's definitely not something that's a predictable thing week to week. So I am not necessarily projecting him as someone that you can trust for fantasy. All right. The next guy we're going to talk about is Bryan Edwards. He is like a fantasy darling. There are just guys that fantasy Twitter loves.
Yes.
After laying a goose egg in week 9, he showed up, caught three of four passes for 88 yards and a touchdown, slightly edging out Hunter Renfrow in terms of fantasy production. Renfrow did see more targets and is much more consistent in terms of production. How do you feel about Bryan Edwards? Are you sending it on him as a wide receiver three, or is that cap?
No, it's cap. Bryan Edwards, another one of those unpredictable guys in fantasy football. And there is a strange and bizarre love affair with Bryan Edwards in the fantasy football community. I've never been part of that groupthink in regards to this particular player. I think we all fell in love with the bulging biceps that were just glistening in the summer sun when we were all just, you know, thirsty for any kind of fantasy information that we could have gotten like June. And people just automatically said, well, hey, it's Bryan Edwards season. It was just like we saw Mike Davis's thighs and our eyes popped out of our sockets. We're like, dude, that cat's going to the moon, top five. You know, he's going to be like the Dogecoin of running backs. But it's, you know, it's just not the case here with Bryan Edwards. You know, no more than five targets in a single game this season. That's really all the evidence that you need to have. Now, he's got a touchdown two of the last three. Oftentimes, you would talk about a sweat session. It's playing him every week because, generally speaking, he doesn't show up until like 5 minutes left in the fourth quarter. And I'm really worried about this Las Vegas Raiders offense as a whole. They were humiliated on national television by a largely leaky Kansas City Chiefs defense. Derek Carr was just discombobulated, out of sorts. It was a frustrating game to watch with any kind of investment in this offense, with the exception of maybe Edwards. And, you know, the schedule, he'll have his moments. But again, pinpointing exactly when he's going to blow up is anyone's best guess. So, cap for me, I'm passing.
It's very frustrating to watch this Raiders offense because Carr, at the beginning of the season, was playing like MVP caliber football. And obviously, there have been numerous off-field distractions for them. So I don't think it's Bryan Edwards' season quite yet. I'm not ready to go full send on that. All right, the last guy we're going to talk about is Tyler Conklin. We already kind of mentioned him. Yeah. He popped off in week 10 with a pair of touchdowns on just 3 catches and 11 yards. So the volume is not necessarily impressive, though he has seen at least 5 targets in 6 of the last 7 games, which is respectable for a tight end. Are we going full send on Conklin as a fringe tight end one, or is the lack of volume make this cap?
Oh, God, knowing it's like a desolate landscape at tight end. There's whirling tumbleweed and zombies roaming the plains. I mean, he's borderline. You know, I want to get, you know, splinters in the old sphincter with this one, but I'm going to say cap. There's one reason why. You know, again, he was largely touchdown dependent in this last game, and he delivered. He scored not once, but twice. Fantastic. I had Tyler Conklin in that same 14-team league in which I had Rhamondre Stevenson, so that was a fantastic streaming option, and I was just playing the matchup because the Chargers largely been devoid against tight ends defensively this season. But, you know, you look at the numbers, he's tight end 31, Samantha, in red zone target percentage. That's not alluring. It's unappealing. It's unattractive. And, you know, it's just going to be a function of the matchup. And you look at the matchups remaining, and none of them really just stand out wonderfully on paper. You know, the best matchup he's got left against the LA Rams, that would be in week 16. They've allowed the 13th most fantasy points to the tight end position. Everybody else outside of that, and many of them outside the top 20. So, you know, I think his best days have already happened. And for me, again, I'd rather go with an Adam Trautman. Yes. Tied to Trevor Siemian, who has a noodly arm. But, you know, Conklin, I think, again, the best days are now behind him.
Yeah, I think the touchdowns are a little deceiving. I would much rather have Dan Arnold than Conklin if you're looking on the waiver wire right now. All right, Rod, we have 9 more rapid fire questions. And we will get you out of here. So question 13 is, name one player you just can't quit or you always find yourself making excuses for.
That's always a mandatory Montgomery. Duh, for me. I mean, absolutely. Dave Montgomery's my guy, my dude. I love him. There's some others. You know, for some weird, sick, strange reason, love Boston Scott as well. And for years,
a good game, so that's
he did well. I mean, look, I like kind of the short little guys. I can pick him up, put him in my pocket, kind of carry him around. Boston Scott's one of those guys, and I was always strangely an apologist for Royce Freeman. Maybe Royce Freeman's season's gonna happen in Houston. It won't, but yeah, you never know.
Amazing. All right, next question: predict when the Bears will win their next Super Bowl. You told me you were a Bears fan before this, so
it'll be after my death. And I'm planning to lead a very long life, Samantha. It's not going to happen. Then again, I was a Cubs, you know, I'm a Cubs fan, and I said the Cubs are never going to win a World Series in my lifetime either. It happened in 2016. I nearly died that night through the rain delay and the nervousness and all that. I have no idea. I will say this about my beloved Bears: we have found our quarterback, and I am excited for what the future holds with Justin Fields. When we get Matt Nagy's horrible coaching ass out of the Windy City, it needs to happen now.
Fair enough. When you gave me this pessimistic answer, I was curious if that was because you were low on Fields, but it certainly seems like he is not the problem in that organization. No. All right. Give us one Bears player who you think is underrated for fantasy.
Well, I mean, honestly, Khalil Herbert is really interesting to me for his long-term trajectory, particularly those people in dynasty leagues. He showed a lot, and I did some scouting on him. And, you know, among the, you know, lower-tiered guys in the last NFL draft, his tape really stood out. I mean, he's a great one-cut-and-go runner, fits his zone scheme to a T, excellent after initial contact, all that stuff. Check, 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 check. It showed up on the field when given an opportunity. And the other guy I think is really ascending right now is Cole Kmet. Cole Kmet is quickly becoming the best friend of Justin Fields He's got great athletic skill set and build, and I think his star is only going to ascend. So those are two guys I'm really excited about the future for. We'll see if the Bears end up paying Montgomery after next season. But, you know, they're in good hands with Kmet and Herbert if Montgomery were to march on. Of course, Justin Fields, too, being a centerpiece. So, yeah, those are the two guys I like best.
Speaking of underrated fantasy players, was Joe Flacco ever elite, yes or no?
Oh, hell no. Not remotely close. He was elite for, you know, a couple of playoff stretches. That's it. And then it became a thing with certain publications on the internet, and it just, you know, it ran rampant. It became viral. No, not remotely elite. He should never sniff the Pro Football Hall of Fame in Canton, Ohio. But yeah, Joe Flacco, terribly mundane, woefully average, Samantha.
Fair enough. Well, based on your pessimism about the Bears, I assume you don't think this is the year. So what needs do the Bears need to address during this year's draft?
Yeah, the secondary needs some help. You know, I like Jalen Johnson a lot, but, you know, some of the other DBs are very much a work in progress. You know, defensively, they're not getting a whole lot in terms of the pass rush game. Khalil Mack, I think, has been a bit of a disappointment. You know, they need to get back to being the black and blue Bears, where they would just rock 'em, sock 'em, robot you in the mouth, and they run down your throat. The running down your throat part is there with Bill Lazor helping out, you know, within this offensive scheme. And I think they've got enough weapons. Free Allen Robinson, you know, he really should go somewhere else where he actually has a passer and give the ball consistently. And maybe, you know, Fields, with his growing confidence, will be able to do so down the stretch. You know, they look good right before the bye week. And I like Darnell Mooney quite a bit. I mentioned Kmet. So offensively, the line's been great, better than advertised. It's defensively where the Bears need to address all their various holes.
Fair enough. I've been very over-leveraged with Darnell Mooney and Allen Robinson shares this year. So very disappointing there. But I love the signs of life that I saw before the bye, as you mentioned. So maybe we will see the Bears turn it around. All right. Who should a manager's top waiver ad be this week?
Well, if Rhamondre Stevenson is there, it's him. If he is not there and you're in a very challenging and competitive league and you didn't make shrewd moves like Samantha and I pick up Stevenson a week or two ago, and then you had the audacity to plug him into your lineup and reap all of the 20 fantasy point goodness. I still think D’Onta Foreman is also on that list. As I mentioned before, to Adam Troutman, if you're desperately seeking a tight end, those guys are widely available right now in Yahoo leagues. And I would definitely put in a waiver wire claim for both of those guys, and Cam Newton too, obviously, you know, for streaming purposes. And there is no way in hell he should be available in a super flex or two quarterback league. And if he is, you know, to smash the piggy bank, whatever you got left in fab cash, throw it all at Cam.
Love it. All right. Three more questions. Give me one player who you think is primed for a big fantasy season next year.
Next season. You know, there are a couple of players that are really interesting to me. You know, I think Elijah Mitchell is proven a ton to me here this year. And I'll be really curious to see where he goes in fantasy drafts next season, because his skill set is otherworldly right now. I mean, he's exceeded all expectations. And I'm a big proponent of yards after contact, missed tackle rates. And he has excelled in those areas. I mean, he's number two among eligible running backs in yards after contact per attempt. Kyle Shanahan is still going to be there. This is still going to be a run-first system. You're probably going to have Trey Lance more than likely be the starter. So having that dual-threat quarterback to open things up, you know, some of the spy action, the RPO plays that you can take advantage of. I think Elijah Mitchell is going to turn a tidy profit. Probably guy right now, depending upon how he finishes, maybe round three, maybe round four. And then, you know, in a couple of years, we're going to be talking about him as a first-round fixture in fantasy drafts.
Wow, that is bold, but I am very ready to eat my words about him earlier season. I just didn't love that how much people were spending their fab on him, but obviously that did pay off for them.
Yeah, big time. Yeah.
All right. How many attempts would it take you to make an extra point?
Let's see. If I had a week of hot yoga to prepare and to limber up and, you know, stretch out to ensure that I'm not, you know, tearing my groin or a hamstring or a glute or anything else that I'm surely going to do on the ski slopes at Breckenridge at some point in my life, Samantha. I would say if you set it over under a 4.5, might be able to get the under on that.
Ooh, that's actually very impressive. It would take me many, many attempts. Dan Harris told me 200 attempts for him. So, wow. That is impressive. All right. Finally, if you had one cardinal rule to tell someone just getting into fantasy this year, what would it be?
What I would say is this: don't overvalue the fantasy draft. I know there's a lot of pomp and circumstance and celebration because of the socialization of getting together with your ladies, you're getting together with your guys, you're getting together with your people. The beverages are flowing, the smack talk is spewing, and everybody's having a wonderful time. And there's just so much investment into that singular event, as wonderful as it is. But it's not the be-all, end-all to your fantasy season because of the ridiculous roster attrition and turnover that exists in fantasy football every single year. I always say this, Samantha, there is the fantasy football equation. It's part of three parts. One part is the draft. The next part is trades and transactions. So that includes waiver wire moves, roster moves, whatever it is. And the last part, luck. Yeah. You know, can you survive the dastardly injury imp and that vicious bite week in and week out? Can you survive the ineptitude to say like a Brandon Ayuk for the first several weeks that you spend a lot of draft capital on? You know, these are things that are just unpredictable. You don't see them coming. And, you know, you got to pivot like Ross with couches on Friends. And, you know, and that's the be all end all in fantasy. So just don't overvalue the fantasy draft and its impact on your fantasy season.
I totally agree. I think that people place way too much emphasis on that and like obsess about their draft grades or whatever. Like, no one cares. Get your guys. Nice. And like, the season is so young. So you have a lot of chances to turn it around, even if you had a bad draft. All right. That will do it for this round of 21 questions with our esteemed guest, Brad Evans. Brad, I cannot thank you enough for joining me during this insanely busy time. Please tell everyone where they can find you this NFL season.
Samantha, I appreciate the time and having me on. You can find me all over the place. I'm a busy man. You can find me on SiriusXM Fantasy Sports Radio, Fade the Noise, 2 to 4 p.m. Eastern, Monday through Friday. I have a Sunday morning show I do solo. When I roll out of bed and shake off the hangover at like 9 a.m. Eastern on that channel, I've got a couple of podcasts, a Fade the Noise podcast, a Fantasy Fast Track podcast. Get wherever you get your podcasts like this show, download it, listen to it, get in, get out in 20 minutes or less. And every episode, I have a television show on Stadium that I do called The Fantasy Sports Book. And I'm writing on Bally Sports, three articles a week and doing all kinds of fun StreamYard videos for them on social media at Noisy Huevos. And Samantha, I will not see you on the slopes. However, I will see you in the chalet drinking a fine IPA, and I will toast you then.
Thank you so much. And seriously, you have been insanely entertaining. So definitely go follow Brad and check out all his work on Bally Sports and all over the podcast space. As a reminder, Sean Kerner and Chris Raybon are here on the Fantasy Flex every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, giving you guys all the DFS waiver wire and rankings info to help you dominate your fantasy leagues. I will be back this Thursday with my mailbag episode, speaking of which you should email any mailbag questions to mailbag@actionnetwork.com. Thanks again for listening. Please rate and review our show on Apple Podcasts. Download us wherever you like to listen, and we will see you next time on the Fantasy Flex presented by PrizePicks. Peace out, y'all.